How many people are there?
And I can't, let me check right now. We have three people that just joined and the people starting to join.
Okay.
All right, we have around 200 people registered to the session, but most of the people watch the session in the playback.
Yeah.
All right, welcome everyone to the 2020 APAC Groundbreakers Virtual Tour by APACO UC. This year, our event will be the biggest one ever done with 174 sessions, including no more sessions, workshops, and hands-on labs from 124 different speakers over 11 days. Also, it will cover sessions on four different languages. Please remember to register to as many sessions you can, and all sessions will be available to replay as many times you want for 2 weeks after the initial session date and time. You can also interact with the speaker at any time during that 2 weeks by posting questions or comments directly in the playback session page. I would like to say thanks to our Oracle user groups and Java user groups that made this event possible, and also to our sponsors, Oracle Groundbreakers and CloudDB. Now for today's session, where it all comes together, doing secure payments with APEX with Alan Aretsen. Please feel free to make questions at any time during this session by using the Q&A option of Zoom webinars, and Alan will be answering all questions at the end of his session. If you have any issues during this session, please let me know by using the chat option of the webinar, and I, Francisco, as the moderator, will be responding and helping you. Now, without any more delays, I would like to leave you with this amazing session by Alan Aretsen. Alan, the room is all yours.
Okay, thank you very much for this nice introduction. Welcome all to this presentation about APEX and secured payments. So first of all, I'd like to start tell something about myself. So my clicker doesn't respond very well. Let's see if this one responds.
Yeah, I can see your photo like in a beach in the sand with database consultancy in the top.
Yeah, there's some delay in my clicker. So I grabbed the mouse. I will continue with the mouse. So my name is Alan Aretsen. I'm from the Netherlands. And a few years ago, 3 years ago, in fact, I started my own consultancy company. I'm single employee. I'm doing most of the times Oracle APEX, and I try to integrate some Oracle JET, so now and then. So in 2017, I was surprised by the ACE Award, and if you want to follow me, you can follow me on Twitter. Please follow me or post a note, and I will answer your questions. So first of all, what you see and what I'm telling you today is not that I'm trying to convince you to do the things I do and to do it the way I do. So I just see ways of solving problems, and I would like to share this with you. So please keep that in mind. So about the ACE program, there are more than 500 technical experts over the globe, and they help you with these presentations and making blog posts, writing books. So if you think you're also should be one of them, you can go to this Oracle Groundbreakers website, and you can see how to nominate people or how to nominate yourself. So for this presentation, I went to the Oracle Cloud free tier, which is offered since I think almost 2 years now. There you can get two autonomous databases, which each 20 gigs. I mean, I think some compute virtual machines and a lot of other stuff all for free. All this stuff in this presentation, I used it in the free database, and it works amazing. So why should I come up with a presentation about this? Why should I come up with a presentation that where all the techniques that were used in all those different presentations, I put them together and I try to make one presentation. So should there be maybe a reason for that? Huh? So why do I think this is useful for you? Well, first, my customer needed a payment portal. And he asked me to program something for that. And the techniques I used for that were very, very cool. I really liked them. And I did see presentations, all these techniques before, but I never saw them in one presentation. And I would really like to glue it together and make one big presentation about how this works. So let's see if we can put it in 45 minutes. So the first thing you need to do is find a payment provider, service provider. And what is exactly a service provider? What does it do? Well, if you want to allow payments from your web shop, you will need a payment provider. A payment provider takes care of a lot of you. Yeah? So there is a wide possibility to choose for which bank payments or which payment method you want to use. You can use credit cards or you can use PayPal. So this payment provider takes care of that. Secondly, the transactions are safe. So you don't have to program any extra stuff to make it safe. It's safe because you use this payment provider. And after the customer has paid via this provider, you get a confirmation that it's paid. And after a while, you get your money from the payment provider, right? Hmm? So there are a lot of payment providers you can choose. Which one you choose is a matter of experience or what others say to advise you or what technology you want to use. So for my customer, I used Molly. And not this kind of Molly, by the way. This Molly, of course. Hmm? And why I used it is because on the previous side of my customer, they already used this. So it was a normal step to do. So first I had to do, first you have to do, because for me it was already done. So you have to set up this payment provider. So if you want to set up Molly, I can imagine with other payment providers, there's a similar process going on. Yeah, you have to create an account, fill in some details, and you also need to fill in some important details like your bank account number and which payments methods you will use. Like if you want to only let them pay by credit card or with Apple Pay, this you can configure at this payment site. So what you also can do is you can customize the screen where the actual payment is done. So from your web page, you'll be redirected to the payment site. And this is not your website, but you can, with Molly, and I believe with others too, you can change your site that it looks more like your own website. So after you set up Molly, which can take a few days because all your stuff is double checked by the Molly employees. So it can take a few days before it actually works. Yeah? But after you set it up, you can start to read the manual. And there's a lot of information on how the APIs work. So lucky for you, I already did that. And before we start to do actual payments, I would like to list the payments that are already there. It's simple, very simple use case. And we can check whether the infrastructure is working properly. So there's a lot that can go wrong, of course, with firewalls, ACLs, SSL connections, wallets, all kind of stuff that's in your database. Yeah. Sorry. So I read the documentation partly for you because it's a lot of documentation. And I came up with these available APIs. And practically for this example, we need two of them, I think, maybe three. And this is also what you will need in a simple situation. So in this session, we start with the payments API. So, and in the payments API, if you read a little bit on it, you will see that you can create a payment. And that's what I would like to do later. So first, I like to start with listing the payments. So it sounds very easy, it's straightforward. But I don't have any payments yet. So please, if you want to populate the list, scan this code, wire $100 to COVID Molly Daemon. Thank you very much. So in the documentation, you can find a simple curl example on how to get the list. So I can test my part of this part of the infrastructure already. So I don't have to use Apex at the moment. I just go to the command line and start using it. So in this curl example, I see they make use of an authorization key. I'm going to get back to this later. So I need, don't forget about this. Yeah? So what you also see is in this documentation is an example of how the response will be. So we can already make an advance on that and program this in our application. So, but let's first test the connection. We use curl, like I said. And curl, with curl, you can send messages to web servers. So what we need right now is the GET protocol. We need to get information from this server. And this is the endpoint we are talking to. So we want to get these payments. And this is the authorization string, which is put in the HTTP header variable. So this API key in the authorization string, you can set this up in the Molly settings. There are two settings over there. You can define two API keys, one for the production environment and one for the test environment. So it's very easy and you can use these to authenticate against your app. So, and if you think your key is compromised, you can generate a new one in this setup screen. So the test result on the command line gives this as a result. Well, that's great. So I know my connection works, my configuration works. Apex should do this right now too, yeah? Without any problems. So in Apex, you need to go to the web source modules for this. So in the web source modules, you can do all kinds of calls with web services. So you go to the shared components and you open the web sources and you can start creating yourself for yourself. Yeah? So basically what the web source modules are is an implementation for the API at your site. So the Molly API has an implementation which you can read with various endpoints, and the web source module should reflect this API. Yeah. And so that's what we basically doing over here. So in Molly, I want to use the payments API and the methods API. And from the payments API, I want to use the list payments. So if you look at these two APIs, you will see that in the web that these two APIs are both web source modules, which contain these functions. So let's go to the wizard. We create a web source from scratch. And we choose the simple HTTP. And it's almost very hard to read over here because it's dark. So, and we choose a practical name for the web source. You can choose a name without underscores, but because we use this name later on, although it's double quoted, I like to use the the underscores in there. And at the end, we choose an endpoint, and that endpoint is the same endpoint that we saw in the example. So then we need to set up a remote server. So Apex needs a remote server, and that's a server with a base URL and some endpoint for this web source. So the server is a new one. The Molly is the endpoint, we got it from the example, is the base URL, and the endpoint is what we also got from the example. So we will not set any extra authentication over here. So the HTTP header authentication, that's what we will use right now. So there is a button, discover, over there. So if we click this button, Apex will try to send a message and see if it works. Bam. No, it doesn't work. So what does it say? Unauthorized. So what does it say? This say that we can connect with Molly because this is a reply from Molly. So the connection works, but Molly cannot authenticate my message. And so we know a lot right now. We know that HTTPS works, we know that the firewall works, and that we now have a connection with Molly. So the server response is 401, and that's a direct message that we got from Molly. So let's go a step back and go to this authentication. You can push the advanced button over there. And in the advanced button, you can set up some HTTP variables. And of course, I just told you, I cannot forget it. And what you have to do over here is set the authentication header variable. So if I put in this bearer token, which we saw also in the curl example, it should work. So let's push the discover and we see it works. So we get a message back from Molly with some information. You can even see more details, like what kind of JSON it is and what kind of responses there are in it. So that's very nice. So let's start with this and see how it worked out. So let's create the web source. And now you are in the web source page. What you see over here is that Apex already created an operation named get. So that's already there. So that's very nice. And what we see more is I was thinking about what we can do. Okay, that is the remote server. So the remote server has the name apimolly.com. So you can change this name of the remote server in another place if you like. So this remote server, you can use it also for other web source modules. Yeah. Okay, so now we have defined this hook to the other API, and we can start to use Apex to create a report on this. So let's start on the page. We create this page based on the interactive report. Just give it a name. And let's make sure it comes up in the menu. And what we now do, we can choose not only to use a local database connection, but you can also use a web source as a source for this report. So if you choose this, you can select a few columns and let's create the page. Yeah. So as a web source module, of course, you can you can choose the web source that you want to choose. So most of these settings are which web source you want to use. And if you want to use the database connection, you can, of course, change later on if you change the report attributes. So if you go back to your page, your report is shown. And what you see over there right now is that you see a few columns. Like you see the count was nil, so there's no data. That's because we didn't have any data in it, of course. And the automatic discovery of the columns didn't find the right columns. It did find a bunch of columns, but not the columns that I wanted. So the JSON that it received back from Molly is apparently bigger or different than Apex can handle in the automatic column discovery. Yeah, over here, you see that count is zero. So let's see what we can change about this this operation that is doing the get. So let's go back to the web source module definition. And what you see over there is the button edit data profile. So with this, in the discovery, a data profile was created for us. And we can edit this right now. And you can see, you can define all the columns over there, and you can define which part of the JSON should go in which column. So if you click this button, you come in this screen, and on the left side, you see that there are a bunch of columns over there that are defined, like the count, what we just saw. We can use the rediscover data profile button over here. Then it will send a message again and try to do the same it already did in the wizard. So you can also edit this data profile and set the right columns. And that you can do based on the examples we saw in the Molly documentation. So the rediscovery, if we have some data in it, we did a rediscovery, and you see that there were a lot of more columns in there. So you will see this. So first I put in some data, then I did the rediscover, and then I saw there were a lot of more columns, and somehow Apex flattened it all out, and these are the column list in the data profile. And that's not exactly what I wanted. I wanted only some other columns, and I couldn't delete all the columns because it was already used in my report. So I had to remove my report first, and then delete some columns and add some new columns and change it. And it is very important because that means that you need to set up your web source module the right way before you start programming. Yeah? You can change later on if you like, but if you already use these columns in the report, then you first have to remove these columns and then you can change the web source. So if I look at the data profile, I wanted less columns. And we noticed that all the JSON columns are now in a definition, and I only need the embedded payments part. So how can I fix this? So the payments part contains all the information I need about the payments. And this, what you now see scrolling, is what I want to see in my report. So what you can do in your data profile, you can set some kind of row selector that it would only take the embedded payments over there. So if you go to the data profile, you can enter this row selector, underscore embedded dot payments, and then Apex will look in this object in the JSON object, and will only see the columns that are in there. So you can push the rediscover button and replace the data profile. So now it looks more like this. But I'm very keen on the naming. And what you see is over here is that it's named value 2 and value 3, and that doesn't make any sense for me. So I renamed these column names and I reordered them so the column order is more natural. And at the end, I got this list where you can see that really the amount is called amount instead of value, and the currency and so on. So you will see I did it for all the columns, and now I think this data profile is right and I like to use it. So if you have small changes on your web stores, you can just synchronize the columns from your Apex region. And in my case, because I had to do a lot, I replaced the whole report. Yeah. And at the end, this was the result. So now I have all the payments. So what I just explained is how to, that you have to first go through this step by step. Take a simple example, test your connection. If the connection works, then start with the Apex. First, do the do a discovery, check if everything works, and then go just more in the complicated parts. Now we're ready to create a payment. So let's look into that. So in the API description, there's a lot of information. So I looked up the payment API and went to the create payment part. And I want not exactly how to learn how these messages will look like, because I already learned part of it in the list payments. I wanted to learn how this payment works. And I came up with this. So the customer, it places the order on your website. And then we create a payment to the Molly. So we call this function or whatever to Molly. Then the customer is redirected to Molly and does the payment. Molly on his side sends a webhook call to our server, and our server responds with that webhook call to check if it's all right, maybe update the status of the payment, and then send this back to Molly. So Molly says, okay, thank you customer for the payment, and we have a happy customer at the end. Okay, so in the middle part, I talked about webhook. So Molly does a call to your webhook. So what is a webhook exactly? Well, there's practically only one way to explain what a webhook is. Everybody knows Shrek. And after the marriage of Shrek and the princess, the newly wedded were invited to the castle for the royal ball. I bet you all can remember. So during this long travel to the castle, Donkey continuously asked, are we there yet? Are we there yet? And Shrek was getting very agitated, and the situation didn't get any better. So, as always, of course. So, wouldn't it be better if Donkey was asleep and he dreamed in a nice meadow about flowers, birds, and then when they arrived at the castle, Shrek would wake him up and say, hey, we are there. And then we have a happy donkey and a happy Shrek. So this is basically how it works. And we are talking about pushing and pulling, you know? And a webhook is more like the push you get from the server. So let's look at the definition, what Molly says about webhooks. So webhooks are used to process a real-time status update. For example, when a payment is paid, you know? So in it is a URL Molly will call with the ID of the updated subject. And when Molly calls your webhook, you should fetch the latest status and process it if the status was changed. So what basically is, Molly sends you a message with an ID, and we have to do something with it. You know? So the example Molly shows is an example of a post message to the server. And the other important part is the ID. It sends back an ID to us. Okay, so let's look a little bit about methods and what kind of operation is there. So usually with a post, this is a create. Something is created in the database and we will return with a 201. And if it's a get, it's a select. No, we're getting something and we will return a 200. Well, a put is an update, patch also an update, and delete is a delete, but they all do return a 200, okay. So when we receive a post, we cannot reply with 201 created if we use a webhook, because we don't create anything. We just, yeah, get some information from Ollie. So with webhooks, we don't send the 201 on a post, but we send a 200, okay, with the post. And then we can continue our process. So basically the idea is that Molly tells there's a status ID change on that ID. So we look the ID up in the database and we ask Molly for the new status. And that's what we do, yeah? And why do we do this way? Because we also could also say, hey, well, the new status of this ID is blah, 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 paid. Well, this is not safe because everyone that can hijack this and could send a message, yeah, this payment is safe. So using webhooks is a more safe way to do this. Yeah. So with webhooks, Molly calls your ID and you said, oh, you immediately say, well, 200, okay, thank you for the message. And then you start your processing. You start retrieving the payment status. So return a 200 as fast as possible and do your stuff in a scheduled job or something. Yeah. You do the payment, you retrieve the payment status. If the ID exists, then it's okay. You update the payment status. And if the ID doesn't exist, well, that's it. You do nothing. So now I want to create this webhook in the database. And that means that you want to do something from outside the database to inside. Yeah. So someone wants to consume data for you. So you need RESTful services for that. So in the first time you will use this, you will see that the schema will not be registered for ORDS. So with the click of the button, you come in this one-step wizard where you can enable the scheme. And what you also can do is install some sample services. So I recommend you to do this because you can use these to test your connection. Yeah. And after you did this, you have this web page where you can create the web services. There's also a PL SQL API for this. And I like to use this because it's very easy to use in your DTAP suite. Now you can enable the scheme from there. So if you look in the sample we just created, we see that we can use the get employees as an example. And we copy this URL over there and we just paste it in our browser and see if the connection works. In that case, if it works and it worked immediately in the cloud, we can see, because it worked, we can use this, we can use our own ODS web service too. So to create this web service that does this, we need to create this test service. So at first, we need to enable the scheme. I just show you. Then we need to define a module. And in this module, we get our templates in this module. In this case, the name is Molly. Then we need to define templates. And in the templates, the handlers go in there. So, and in every template can be more handlers. And then we need to define the handler. And in this case, we do the implement the get handler, which we copied from the info example. So we copy the URL and we can test this. So if you look in the URL, you see that the that the scheme URL mapping pattern is the ADBC, that's the first one. So the module base is the second one, and the third one is the template pattern. So that builds up this URL. And if you test this with URL in your browser, you will see that we have a working test case. Great, so now we can create our own webhook. Yeah, so let's convert the script I just showed you to a webhook script. So this was the script, and let's change this. So we changed the pattern and we called webhook, simple name. Of course, the method was a post, and we need to do some PLC call over here. Well, the only thing I will do right now is I will lock the body text. And that's it. It's only to show you how it works. So, of course, a post you cannot test for your, from it within your browser, from in the URL bar. So there are a lot of test tools out there. So I use the API tester. What you can do, just copy your URL over there, choose your method. This is in this case post. And then if you test it, you will see that you get the 200. Okay. So that worked quite easy. Yeah. And if you go to the database, you will see the log message in the database. So now we have our webhook already done. And let's create a payment. Yeah. That's why we're here for, create this payment. So we've seen this API a couple of times, and in the web search modules, we need to add an extra operation to create a payment. Yeah, but first we need an example on what the message looked like. And in this API, this example was there already. You see that beside the curl example, there's also a PHP, Python, and a Node.js example. So in this Node.js example, I could see the exact JSON string that I needed to send. And it looked like this. And we are now sending messages to an API. So we need the web search modules for this. So let's go to the web search modules and add an extra operation. In this operation, we first need to choose the URL pattern. If you don't use the URL pattern, you can also just put a dot in there. And then it means it's a non-existing URL and it will be empty. Then we need to set the HTML method. In this case, it will be post because we are creating something. We are creating a payment. The database operation will be an insert. We will be inserting a new payment and then the body template. So the body template should look something like this. Now we talked about this. The only thing what we see over here is that there are all fixed values in there. We need to replace this somehow with substitution strings. Yeah, so if we create the substitution strings, we can just copy this and add this in the request body template. And now we have to give this substitution strings some kind of value. And that's where the data profile comes in. So the data profile is a mapping between the substitution strings and the values. So I added these strings as column names in this list and gave them some of them a default value. And now the interface is almost ready. We need an extra module parameter because we need to get the result from the web source and parse it later on into PLCcom. So in the module parameters, in the module parameters section, we create an extra parameter and we call it response. And that is the response body of the result. So now we're almost done. We only need to execute this web source and then we get paid. So how to execute this web source? So what I did, I created a package that did all the handling for me. And in this package, I used the Apex functionality to call the web source. Yeah. So this part of the code to execute the web source, I just called my package with some variables from my page and the web source was executed. So what do we need to do before we can execute it? We need to set some values to this operation parameters that we just created, the substitution variables. So the body template is filled in. So how we do that? We need to do that via PLSQL. So in this package I created, I first created the parameters variable. And this we need to go and fill in. So for every parameter, we need to set the value of it. And you can use the Apex exec package for this. So for some, we use the parameters out from our function. For others, we just use a constant. So, and if we set up all the parameters, we can execute the web source. So we need to choose the static ID of the web source. And we need to say what operation we need to use, the one we defined. And then we need to push in all the parameters. And if we run this, there will be a response. And the response is in the module parameter called response. So now we have this response, and this is a JSON. And this JSON needs to go in some kind of table. So for that, I wrote this function that converts the payment to an object or a record. Yeah. And what I also do is I log the payment in our in the database. Yeah. So next part, we need to parse the result from the mobile Molly service and convert it the JSON into my record type. So let's first look on how this create payments response looked like. So this information I got from the API. It's a lot, yeah, but I don't need everything. So this is a call to my function that converts to JSON. And this is how the record looks like. So I only need these values from the JSON. So let's create a function. I created the function and the response, the input parameter is a clop, and that is the response we got from the call to the webhook. And the record is return that's my payment type. So we need to select something into this record from my JSON response. And in Oracle 12, what you typically we need to return those, and we need to return this record, of course. And in Oracle 12, what you typically can do is use the JSON table function. And the first parameter is the JSON you want to parse. Yeah. So, and the dollar sign means we start at the root of the JSON that we starting to parse, and we need to parse these columns. We need to parse the order ID, and the order ID you can find in the metadata.orderID part of the JSON. So this is where you can find the Molly ID, the timestamp, status, it's cancelable, and the checkout. And it all works with this dot notation. So to make it more nice, I use an alias, of course, and I want the response in the upper in the uppercase. So this is how it typically will look in 12C. In 18C it can look different. So 12C looks like this with the dot notation, and in 18C you can skip the quotes and writing immediately in the dot notation, except for the last one because it starts with an underscore and then you need to use the old style. Yeah. So as a summary, what did we do? So the customer places an order at your application. Then you create a payment in Apex, and therefore we use the web source modules and the Apex exec package. After that, you redirect the customer to Molly, and Molly does the payment over there. And during that payment, Molly calls your webhook, and that's an ORDS RESTful service. So we send status 200 back. We get the status of the payment, and we use also the web source module and the Apex exec package for that. We didn't explain it in this session, but it works the same way as you do the list. Then your customer is redirected back to your page, and you can thank your customer. And at the end, we have a happy customer. So more summaries is, for using external services, we use web sources in Apex. We use the Apex exec package to call these web sources. And we use ORDS RESTful services for hosting any services. We use JSON in the database. So what you can do is parse JSON messages with this functionality. And at the end, I try this all in the free cloud, and it works immediately over there. So I hope you had a nice session and you can watch this later on, and you can try this, all the examples. You can try it also immediately in your own situation if you like. So if there are any questions right now, you can put them in the question area. And if there are any questions later on, just drop me a message on my Twitter account. Well, thank you for being here. So are there any questions?
Yes, we have a question. Can you send a payment receipt to your customer after successful payment?
Can you send a payment receipt to your customer after successful payment? Yes, so after the payment is done, you will be redirected. You will redirect your customer to a site of your choice. So this can be your own site, an Apex page. And from that Apex page, you can thank the customer, of course, but you can also put a download link on there, for example, to download it. What you can also do is in this procedure where you redirect your customer to the page, you can send a mail or something like that to the customer. You can also configure Molly that they send a payment receipt to the customer. Okay, I now also see the questions. What about the ACLs to call Molly? Yeah, I didn't cover that in my presentation. In the cloud service, the ACLs are already fixed. I don't know exactly what configuration it is. Maybe that all HTTPS traffic is accepted. Yes, you will have to configure this on your own server.
Fantastic. We also have a question in the chat saying, are we having live demo or information only, which can be found on the website?
There's no live demo. Like I said, in the presentation, there were a lot of examples in there. I think you will come pretty far if you use this examples.
Fantastic. All right, Alan, looks like this was all the questions. Your session will be available for 2 weeks for playback in the conference website, and everyone can watch this session as many times they want it. And if they have any extra questions, they can also post the question or comments to the playback page, and you will be notified of the questions, and then you'll be able to respond on your earliest convenience. Saying that, thank you so much, everyone, and please be safe. Thank you, Alan, for sharing your knowledge with the community.
Thank you for having me. And have a good one.
You too. Everyone, have a wonderful day or night. Cheers. Bye.
Bye.